Hello everybody, how are you? I hope that you guys had a good weekend, and I hope that my audio is working. We've had a bunch of technical issues getting started the other couple of days. Just to double check, can you hear me? All I see is that people think I'm on time, which is, I guess, also a bit of an impressive feat. But good! I'm glad you guys can hear me, because we're going to go and finish up with the MathCounts practice competition number 4 today. Now, I'm going to emphasize again something that I had said at the beginning of the very first live stream, which is that it's a huge pleasure and honor to be able to work with MathCounts. This is actually the contest that got me interested in math a long time ago. And I want to emphasize that what we're doing today is actually an official collaboration with MathCounts. That's why we have the MathCounts problems here. They're actually all copyrighted, and we're using them with permission. So thanks to MathCounts for letting us work together to go and have some fun. So the question is, will it actually take 1 hour? Actually, no. We probably will be done relatively quickly today, just because we only have a few questions left in the target round. I reserved the 1 hour because I wasn't sure if we would need, 3 hours to go and solve all of these problems. I would be willing to answer a few random questions, with some of the rest of the time. But today will probably be quite a bit shorter than the other ones. So let's go and have some fun. And let's see if we can figure out the rest of these target round questions together. So here's where we were yesterday. We got to practice number 4, target question number 2. And this was something about adding together some consecutive positive integers. What's next? Let's find out. Aha! Question number 3. Clifton left 280 acres of land to be divided among his sons Al and Bob in the ratio 4 to 3, respectively. How many acres should Al receive? Okay, so this seems quite reasonable. If we have to break something into the ratio 4 is to 3, the way you think of that is what fraction goes to each person, right? So if you have a ratio of 4 is to 3, then what fraction goes to each part? Well, 4 plus 3 is 7. So what that means is that Al should get 4 out of the 4 plus 3. That's the fraction that Al gets. And Bob should get 3 out of the 4 plus 3. So that's how ratios work. People are commenting this is easy. That's usually because on a target round, you have 6 minutes to do both questions. And usually the first question is easier and the second one is harder. Since the problem here is 3 is an odd number. That means it's the first of the round. Okay, and so I want 4/7 times 270 to get the 280 to get the answer. So I want, let's write it this way. Al gets 4 over 7 times 280. I don't need a calculator for this. 7 into 28 is 40. And so the answer is 160. And that's what I'm going to propose. As you can see, I said this comment, I don't want to use a calculator. Why? It's not because I think calculators are bad. In fact, I always use computers for all my work. The reason is because with a calculator, I'm scared of getting it wrong by typing wrong. And with this, it's very dangerous. If you do 4 divided by 7 times something, if your order of operations is wrong, you might get a nonsense answer. But it's easier for me just to look at it and say, I see how I can do that. Bang, bang, 40, 4 times 40, 160. Okay, let's keep going. Question number 4. Oh, I should check if the answer is right. It is! Okay. Question number 4. George and Leah each toss a tetrahedral die with faces numbered 1 through 4, and then multiply the two resulting numbers. If the product is less than 9, George wins. Otherwise, Leah wins. What is the probability that Leah will win? Express your answer as a common fraction. So I need to be able to tell whether the product of the numbers is less than 9 or more than 9, and they're tetrahedral, it's 4 by 4. This makes me want to draw a multiplication table. And that also is the probability space. It's like all of the different possibilities. So if I have these 4 possible dice that I'm throwing, I'm going to draw it like a multiplication table, which is only 4 by 4, like this. All right. And the numbers that I'm multiplying together, I'm going to multiply numbers. That was supposed to be a 2. 1, 2, 3, 4. 1, 2, 3, 4. And what's interesting is I'm supposed to know whether the product is less than 9 or more than or equal to 9. And we want to know what's the chance Leah will win. So I guess if it's less than 9, Leah loses. Oh, there are interesting ways to do this question. Here's how I'll do it. I'll say, you know, if I had a 1, if one of the dice was a 1, then all of these 4 would actually all be losers for Leah. 1, 2, 3, and 4. These are the 4 outcomes. It's actually not even important to write out what the products are. All that's important is there's going to be a pattern. It's going to actually look like what's called a rectangular hyperbola, but we'll see that soon. So for 2, how do you get less than 9? Oh, wait. It looks pretty common. Okay, 2, 4, 6, 8. It's not actually important to know the exact numbers. All that's important is that all of these are going to be less than 9. And the way I knew they'd all be less than 9, by the way, is because I knew that even if I went 2 times 4, that's less than 9, so all the rest are also less than 9. Basically, once something is less than 9, all the rest are. Now, if I have the 3, that's how I'm doing it. 3 times 3 is 9. I'm going to use green because that's Leah wins. Okay, but anything to the left of it is going to be less than 9. Actually, 3 times 2 is 6, 3 times 3 is 1, and it's not actually important what these numbers are, but I'm just writing them there anyway. On the other hand, going forward, those will be bigger than 9. And again, it's not important what the number is, but I'm just drawing it there so that people who are watching this live stream can see everything. Okay, if I want to continue, actually, I can also use something called symmetry. This is supposed to be symmetrical. If you ever looked at a times table is symmetrical across this line, so that what's on this side and this side are always the same. And so, since you have a symmetrical times table, I actually already know that this is also going to be winning for Leah. I know this is going to be losing for Leah, and this is going to be losing for Leah. And the way that this works, if I multiplied and I won for Leah, and you go get one of the dice to be even bigger, well, Leah's going to win even bigger. So we're done, because now we can see the chance that Leah wins is 4 over 16, or 1/4. Okay, if you were in a hurry and trying to do this problem fast, the way you would do it is you would just like look and see where the, like see, look over here, it's like, all of these Leah loses. Look over here, 2 times 4 is 8, all of these Leah loses. What about the 3 row? Then you find out that at this 9, that's where it changes over. That means from here on, Leah wins. From there back, Leah loses. And that's one way you could do it without even writing out all these numbers here. I saw some people saying things like, oh no, got it wrong because of the 9. That's why you have to read the problem carefully. Those of you who watched my live stream yesterday saw that I made a mistake because I read this like, what was it? Before. I read the word before and I didn't realize it meant before and not equal to. So this is less than 9, not equal to 9. Okay. Oh, I see. People got it wrong for another reason. It's like if you just answered the other question, which was the probability that Leah will lose. That's the other way, 3/4. Okay. And it is 1/4. Next question. Oh no, these are scary. These questions are scary because it's so easy to do it wrong. All right, gotta drink our water. Why I say it's easy to do it wrong is because it's so easy to look at it and think you counted them all. If I want to count rectangles, the way I'm going to do it to try to avoid mistakes is I'm going to realize that every rectangle has like a top and a bottom, okay? Like a top side and a bottom side. And I'm going to count the rectangles with different types of top sides and bottom sides. So, for example, if the top side is on the very top, let's see. What's the easiest way to think of this? Well, I'm looking at this. I'm trying to say, is that the most efficient way? Yeah, that will work. That will work. So I'm going to look at all the different possibilities. One possibility is that the top is green. Oh, let's use a thicker line. The top is green, if that was supposed to be green. The top is green, if that's the top line, and the bottom line is this pinkish thing. If I do that, how many rectangles can I make? Do you see how I'm doing this? I'm trying to make sure I don't count wrong. So if the top line is green, and this is the top edge of the rectangle, and the bottom edge is that purple thing, how many rectangles can you make? Only one, okay? So here's how I'm going to do that. I'm going to try to keep track of my notes by writing a number. Oh, I know. Yeah, that's fine. I'll write that number there. I'm just using purple. It's like, if that was where the bottom is, it's 1. Now, there's another possibility. What if the bottom edge is here? if the bottom edge is here, now how many rectangles are there where the top edge of the rectangle is the green one and the top edge of, sorry, the bottom edge of the rectangle is the purple one? Still only one. Because if you want the top edge of the rectangle to be the green one, you really don't have much choice. Do you see what I mean? If the top one is the, if the top edge is green, it actually has to be just this one rectangle. Okay? So there's one more here. And actually, I already saw a pattern. One. And I'll write another one here to mean that if the bottom edge, if the bottom edge of the rectangle was this line, and the top edge is that line, there's only one rectangle you can make. So now I have these three, and I'm going to combine the three, and I'll write a one up here. A three up there. So I'll combine this one plus one plus one, and I'll write a three. And what that three means is that there are three rectangles with this top. Okay? I'm just trying to show you how not to make a mistake. And watch, maybe I'll make a mistake anyway. But we'll see. So that's how I did that part. The next thing I need to do is I need to do another case. Another case is, what if the top edge is this one? If that's the top edge, then what do I have as choices for the bottom edge? Well, here's one choice for the bottom edge. If that's my choice for the bottom edge, how many rectangles are there which have the top here and the bottom there? Ah, it's a combinatorics problem. If you look at this carefully, how do you make a rectangle? You make a rectangle by having a top and a bottom edge, and a left and a right edge. You see, I have one, two, three, four choices to choose from to decide on my left and right edge. So how many ways could you actually go and make a rectangle by, out of these four different vertical lines, choosing two of them? That's called four choose two. We've seen that in this live stream before too. If I want to know 4 choose 2, this is equal to the number of ways to choose 2 from 4. And that's equal to 4 ways to choose the first one, 3 ways to choose the second one, you know, four ways to choose which one I start with. Once that's gone, I have four ways to choose this, 3 ways to decide which of the next ones is going to be my other edge. But I have to divide by 2 factorial, because I could have chosen this one first and then the third one, or I might have chosen the third one first and then the first one, but that's the same rectangle. Okay? So this is a quick way of seeing 4 times 3 over 2. Cancel this way, it's 2 times 3. Cancel this way, it's 2 times 3, and so that's 6. So I know that there are 6 ways if I have that the top edge is the green and the bottom edge is the purple. Oh, I see a pattern already. This is a nice picture. Thanks, MathCounts. They have taste. They came up with some pictures that are easy to think about, because I see a pattern now. Look at this. Let's do this. Now, how many rectangles are there where the top edge is the green and the bottom edge is the purple? It's the same thing we just did. Do you see that? If I want to know how many ways can I make a rectangle where the top edge is here and the bottom edge is here, well then, my only choices are to choose 2 of these 4 vertical lines. Is that okay? So I need to choose 2 of these 4 vertical lines. It's the same thing we just calculated. That's 6. So this is another 6. And now what I'm going to do is I'm going to say, in that case, how many rectangles have this green one as the top edge? 6 plus 6, which is 12. 12 rectangles with this top. Okay, clean up, clean up, clean up. Now we see where this is going. Okay, let's clean up this part too. Well, no, I can leave it. Now suppose this is the top, and suppose this is the bottom. By the way, that's the last case. I have no other options. It's just this is the top and this is the bottom, right? I always let the top go down as I go. All right. So now what is this? It's the same kind of problem. I just need to go and pick 2 out of these 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. I have 6 different vertical lines. I need to pick 2 of them. So the answer for how many ways I can make this rectangle, let's just put it up there because I ran out of space. I need to know what is 6 choose 2. which is 6 times 5 divided by 2, cancel into a 3. 3 times 5 is 15. Therefore, there are 15 rectangles with this as the top, and that's the last option. Okay, so let's clean that off. Boop. 15 rectangles with this top. And that's it. Let's add them all together. So 3 plus 12 plus 15, that is 15 plus 15, it's 30. Okay, so I propose the answer of 30. Let's check if it's right first. It's right. We're good. Okay. Now, notice that what I noticed is that in the chat, there were lots of different answers that people were putting out there. And some people said, you know, you can just count quickly and it's fine. If you notice, there's a difference between what I did with just like, hey, look at it and like count. It is so easy to miscount. You see, the way I did this is a very systematic way where when I wrote down a number, I said I never have to think again of whether or not I'm thinking of a rectangle with that as the top edge. So what I just did here is the foolproof way to go and make sure you get the right answer. Okay? I want to give that as a tip because it's very easy to get confused if you just like randomly count. Okay. And also we got to see that these chooses are really useful. It's much faster than actually going and trying to count how many rectangles there are when you can just say, I choose two of the vertical bars, and that's it. Let's keep going. Question number 6. Oh, and also, you know, I took a while to do it because I was trying to really explain how each of the thought processes worked. But there's no reason you need to take that long to do it. If you're thinking and writing as you think, you could actually get that done much faster. Especially when you notice the patterns. I notice that there are the same numbers coming up over and over again. Wow, there's a word store. Okay, at the word store, each vowel sells for a different price, but all consonants are free. The word triangle sells for $6. Square sells for $9. Pentagon sells for $7. Cube sells for $7. And tetrahedron sells for $8. What is the cost of the word octahedron? This is like the opposite of Scrabble. In Scrabble, the vowels aren't worth very much. You want the like Q's and Z's and X's and J's. But I guess that's not how the word store works. Okay, well, I need to go and figure out what's going on with all of these vowels. Octahedron. What kind of vowels do I have in that? Because that's what I have to answer. How much is the octahedron worth? So the O. Yeah, I see people saying, let's do systems of equations. First, I want to see how lazy I can be. So I want to see, what is this? I've got, let's underline the ones, because otherwise I'll lose track. O, A, E, O. Okay, so what I'm interested in is, what is the cost of two, I'm going to use lowercase. Can anyone guess why I want to use lowercase O instead of capital O? The variable is going to represent like how much it costs. Why don't I use a capital O? Yes, exactly, Sophia, that's right. It would be like 20. Okay, it would look like a zero. So it's two O's plus an A plus an E. I want to know what that is. And now what I'm going to do is I'm going to try to write down what I already know. Okay? So I have over here in the triangle word, I, A, E. I think that's it. So I happen to know that I plus A plus E, I is not the square root of minus 1 today. I plus A plus E is 6, okay? If I have square, that's a U, A, and E. U plus A plus E, that happens to be 9. Pentagon, E, A, O. Wow, they all have E and A. That's cute. O plus A plus E, that's equal to 7. Notice that I reordered it. Even though I said it was E, A, O, I said, well, I see these E and A. I want to put them here. Okay? Could be convenient. Let's keep going. Cube, U and E. U, E. U plus E is equal to $7. And finally, tetrahedron. E, A, E, O. E-A-E-O. Okay, that's two E's. That's an A. There's one A and one O. O plus A. Plus two E is equal to 8. All right, now I've got all these systems. And you notice I didn't do a great job of lining everything up because there's all these like random other things over here. But when I look at this, I'm a little bit of a lazy person. The way I see it is I see an O, A, and an E, and I see two O, A, and an E. If only I could figure out what an O costs, then I'd be done. Okay, this is not how you normally solve systems. This is called the stare at it method. This is not systematic. It's called stare at it. So I'm like, okay, I want to just get another O. I'll find out how much an O costs and add 7. Now, if I want to figure out how much an O costs, or is there another way? I'm looking at this to be like, yeah, okay, that seems reasonable. So if I want to see how much an O costs, I'll look around at the other things I've got to play with. Oh, no. Well, okay, I don't see an efficient way, but I'll say when I look at this thing, I see it. I was hunting for O's. That's how I'm problem solving. I'm hunting for O's. So I stared at these two. I see O's. But when I see these two, I don't see anything that lets me get the value of O. On the other hand, I see how to get E, right? The stare at it method. I see an O and an A. And from E to 2E, it goes up by 1. Guess what? That means E equals 1. Okay, that's useful. This is plus E. So E equals 1. This is not how they usually teach you to solve equations in school, but that's also because you don't usually have this many variables. And also on this problem, it looks nice enough that I think I can probably get it by the stare at it method. So E is 1. If E is 1, now what can I do? Well, I still care about O. I know what O plus A is. That means if I could figure out A, I guess I'd be in good shape. Okay. Well, let's take stock of what we've got. Right? So if I look at this thing, the E is a 1. Is there anything else that's relatively easy for me to pull out? Oh, wait, look at that. U plus E is 7. Let's go get U for free. Okay? So you see, I'm hunting for like what's the easy thing for me to do here. E is 1, then U is 6. Right there. This thing combines here to get U equals 6. Oh. Aha! And I remember seeing, like, if I only could get A, I would be happy. Here's why. My problem-solving method is saying, you see this? I have an O, I have an A, and I have an E. I know what E is. If I could figure out what A is, I'd know what O is. Okay, so let's just go and figure out what O is. To do that, so let's figure out what A is. And there is a way to figure out what A is. It's right here. U, A, and E are 9, and I know what U is, and I know what E is. So, if I take all of these and merge all of them together, now I have U is 6, the E is 1, that's 7, so A is 2. Now we are almost home. So if A is 2, let's go and get the O. All right, so I see people are already getting it in the chat. Excellent. So if I look at this guy, right, E was 1, A was 2, so this is 3. Well, 2 plus 1 is 3. This is 3, therefore O is 4. This looks like some crazy train track. So this tells me that O is equal to 4. Now you're really happy that we used lowercase o, because otherwise you'd be saying I just wrote down 0 equals to 4. But now we're done, because I just need to add O, right? Because I had O, A, and E, that was 7. Add 4, I get 11. So after you do this, this guy becomes 7 plus 4, which is 11. And so that's my answer. With this particular question, I don't actually think there's a much better way to do it than to go and stare at it, simply because there are so many variables. There are standard ways to solve these systems of equations when there are so many variables, but when there really are this many, like 5 of them because there are 5 vowels, it actually is quite painful. So this stare at it method might be better. Let's see if the answer is 11. It is. Okay. We're doing okay on time. Let's go and do the last two questions. Question number 7. All 6 faces of a large wooden cube are painted blue, and then the cube is divided into smaller unit cubes. If 486 of the unit cubes have exactly 1 blue face, how many unit cubes make up the original large cube? One thing I always check on these problems, they're often tricks in these questions. I wanted to know how many faces. Because sometimes these problems are tricky. They tell you, I've got a cube on a table, and you paint all of the faces that you can see. That's five faces, not six. But this is all six faces are painted. Now I have to think about what it looks like. Oh, it's painted blue, isn't it? Why am I using green? It should be blue. So if I have this blue thing, let's call that a cube. Now, if they're all painted blue, it's saying that some of them have exactly one blue face. Well, where are those? That's like this part. I'm saying like the cubes which are there are the ones which are exactly one blue face, and there's like six of them. It's like there's six of this type on here, and so on. So let's just go and figure out how many unit cubes are in that particular surface square. Well, that is going to be 486 divided by 6, because there are 6 faces. And that is, 81. How convenient. So if that's 81, that's a 9 by 9, right? So if this is 9 by 9, don't make the mistake of saying that the cube is 10 by 10 by 10. That's the mistake of forgetting that you actually have an extra cube on this side and an extra cube on that side too. So although this is 9 by 9, the cube is 11 by 11 by 11. Okay? Because it's like, that was 9 plus 1 plus another 1. So it's 11 by 11 by 11. Now I just need to know, what is 11 cubed? This is a fun one, okay? So it does turn out that the answer for 11 cubed comes from Pascal's triangle. 1, 1, 1, 1, 2, 1, 1, 3, 3, 1 is my answer. 1, 3, 3, 1. So, there's a reason for this. The reason for this is, first of all, what's Pascal's triangle? You might have seen this in your teacher's classroom. If you take two numbers and you add them together to get the number underneath, like this, like 1 plus 2 makes 3 and so on, actually the first few up here are the cubes of 11. And there's a reason for that. It's because if you're actually multiplying together 11 by 11 by 11, at some point you're, for example, multiplying 121 by 11. You know how you multiply 121 by 11? Like this. Watch what happens. You write 1, 2, 1, and 1, 2, 1, and if you look at what just happened, this was your 1, but this was 2 plus 1, which is 3. So you see, like this 1 here just fell over there, but then this 3 came from the 2 and the 1 combining. And then this 1 plus 2 is actually also from that 2 and the 1 combining, and this 1 is just from there. So it's actually pretty neat. It doesn't work if you keep going, because Pascal's triangle gets a lot bigger numbers. Although it does work if you carry. So if you got some giant Pascal's triangle stuff down here, since I'm already talking about it, let me just tell you, it's fun. So if I go, the next one is 1, 4, 6, 4, 1. And then if I try to keep going, I get 1. 1 plus 4 is 5. And then this annoying 10. 10, 5, 1. There is no way you can just write it's 1, 5, 1, 0, 1, 0, 5, 1. No, that's wrong. But you have to do some carrying. If you wanted to know what is 11 to the power 5, what you'd do is you'd work from the back. 1, 5, 10. Oh, but the 1 from here carries into this one to make 11. Thank you. But that 11 has an extra 1 in front that carries to the 5. 6, 1. So effectively what I just did is I just did this, except I smooshed them. I did some carrying. This 1 went into the next place value, and then that carried over into the next place value. But this always works. And it's really, really fast to take powers of 11. Let's see if the answer is 1331. Oh, and by the way, you see, I haven't even needed a calculator yet. Remember, I'm the lazy guy who doesn't want to take the calculator out. 1331. And watch, the last question, I'm probably going to need a calculator. What's this? Oh, but the numbers are small. I like that. Maybe I cannot use a calculator too. Darla can complete a job in 8 hours, while Lonnie can complete the same job in 6 hours. Speedy Lonnie. Both Darla and Lonnie begin working on the job together. After working together for 3 hours, how much of the job is left to be completed? Express your answer as a common fraction. Okay, these kinds of things, it's like, how do you do this? Well, look, everyone knows. If Darla takes 8 hours and Lonnie takes 6 hours, then if they work together, you know how many hours it takes if they work together? Obviously, 8 plus 6 hours, right? because it takes 8 hours for Darla and 6 hours for Lonnie. So if they work together, it takes 14 hours to solve. No, that's backwards. It doesn't make any sense. They're working together. It should be faster, right? So this is the classic type of a problem where the reciprocals are important. You don't add together the times. They're working together. If they're working together, the way you think of it is every hour, what fraction of the job does each one finish? Never mind the fact that, you know, like if people are working together on a job, not all jobs can be like really collaborated that efficiently, but that's separate topic. Let's do it this way. So let's instead say in one hour, Darla does what fraction of the job? 1/8 of the job. Of course. And that's because Darla took 8 hours to do the whole job. Well, would take 8 hours to do the whole job. And in the same 1 hour, Lonnie does 1/6 of the job. Okay, now these you do add, right? That means in 1 hour, if they're both working, of course, then the amount of job that gets done is 1/8 plus 1/6. Okay, in 1 hour, together, they do 1/8 plus 1/6. And if I want to add those, what's the common denominator? 24. 8 times 3, 6 times 4, 7 over 24. Okay, well then, if every hour they do 7 out of 24, what's the question asking? 3 hours. So that means in 3 hours, together they do 7 over 24 times 3, which is 7/8. So that's the answer, right? 7/8. No, always read the question carefully. How much of the job is left to be completed? If it's how much is left to be completed, we take 1 minus that. So the answer left is equal to 1 minus 7 over 8, and it's 1 over 8. And guess what? This is question number 8. Do you think MathCounts did that on purpose? So, okay. So that I think that's the answer. Let's double check and let's see. Yes, it is. So we're good. And that actually finishes the target round. And that finishes practice competition number 4. I hope that you guys had fun. I definitely had fun. I see that we're pretty fast for today. You know, we have half an hour left. If people have random questions about MathCounts, I'm happy to answer that. I'm happy to stick around just a few minutes. If people have some random questions about things, I'm happy to answer it. Just because we happen to have time. We don't always have time. I won't have time to discuss more math questions today, just because, as you remember, I used to do these Ask Math Anythings. Those were fun. But today, since we were just doing this thing with MathCounts, I prefer to maybe focus on the math. Ah, yes, Penguin has a question. How do you avoid silly mistakes? Now, did you notice? I did make a silly mistake. How to avoid doing that is always read the question carefully. That's a really important point. All these kinds of things, like how much is left to do? Is it more than? Is it like who wins? Make sure you read that part right. The second thing is that if you notice when I was doing these problems, I would do it in one way, and I would kind of like do really weird other ways of thinking about, do those numbers make sense? I actually pause as I'm doing all of these computations. With every arithmetic computation, I do it, and I also kind of check, did that make sense? That's how I avoid the silly mistakes. I learned this when I was a MathCounts student, and the more creative ways you can find to solve the same problem, the easier it is for you to double check against silly mistakes. Like even this thing about 11 cubed, it's like, I happen to know you can get it through Pascal's triangle, and that's like a nice way to do it. If you didn't have it that nice way, you could also do it the multiplication, which is what you saw me doing, also 121 times 11. More questions. Oh, Ian Lanning has asked, have you ever got to MathCounts Nationals? Well, I have to say I used to go there every year because it's a really wonderful competition that I support, and when MathCounts Nationals was happy to have me there, I was very happy to meet amazing students who, you know, I ended up actually seeing again later through other math competitions or in college. So yes, I have. But that's not your question. You are actually wondering if I got to MathCounts Nationals as a student. And the answer is yes, I did. But that was a easier time. I got to MathCounts Nationals at a time when, you know, there was no YouTube, nobody knew any of this stuff. So the number of people who really were really good was much less. That's how I managed to get to Nationals. You didn't have to be as good back then. Nowadays, you know, it's really, really hard. And so I want to encourage you, whether you get to nationals or not, don't worry. The important thing here is to go and play with these kinds of questions, which really make you think. And then later on, it doesn't matter whether you're into nationals or not. It matters what you do with whatever you learned. More questions. Ah, Banana Watch wants to know, hey, how did you choose banana? Anyway, so Banana Watch wants to know, what did you get on nationals when you competed? I actually got third back in the day. Third, I don't remember. I actually don't know how many points I got. We weren't as smart as you guys nowadays. So the point scores weren't as high. I got third. I was very surprised. But, you know, as I said, it was a simpler time. It was a time when we just didn't know much of anything. And so that doesn't count, like, compared to what you guys are doing today. So more questions. So Bing test, how many blue shirts do you have? A lot. How did you guess? Oh, yes, that's right. People who have watched my live stream have noticed that I go through different kinds of shirts. And when it's cold, I actually always wear these, like, long sleeve blue shirts. But when it's warm, I wear these, like, different multicolored short sleeve shirts. But somehow long sleeves, you know, I don't know why, but like shirts for work, like long sleeve shirts for work, a lot of them just are blue, and I was okay with that. Okay, more questions. Why always blue is a good question. I don't know. It's like a standard color for people wearing like shirts. And honestly, I was happy with blue because then I don't need to think. It's like if they're all blue, I don't have to match anything. Just wear like blue shirt and black pants and should be fine. And you can spend your time thinking about something else. More questions. Somebody asked, Doggy Typer is asking, should you put more practice on algebra or geometry when studying for the AMC8? Now, all of these different math competitions do have different amounts of like different kinds of math in them. I did notice that for the AMC8, there's a lot more algebra than there is geometry. Although I've seen that on MathCounts, MathCounts has a lot of interesting variety. You get questions from, you know, geometry, combinatorics, probability. So for MathCounts, I think MathCounts, there's a lot of topics. For AMC8, I do think algebra is a more critical piece. But we're in MathCounts today, and so hopefully you had the chance to tour through all of these different kinds of math types as we did these problems from the MathCounts practice set. More questions. Alan Lee, what is the greatest piece of advice to someone doing a math competition? I would say, don't worry too much about other people. A lot of times when people do these math competitions, they're thinking about winning or losing or getting beaten. Use these as a challenge for yourself. As you can see, that's what I was doing. Who am I competing with here anyway? Nobody. It's just like, oh, nifty question. Can I solve it? Let's try, right? So the biggest advice is, you'll see these math contests. Somebody will win, somebody will lose, so what? What you can do is you can try to fight with the questions, learn something, and later on when you go and do something really interesting with your life, you'll say, good gracious, all this stuff I did fighting with hard problems from MathCounts was really useful. Do that. More questions. Ah, Penguina. We've got lots of penguins today. Penguina asked, what's a good way to increase calculation speed? So, if you've noticed, the way I did these calculations, I did very few straight up, like, multiply this by this, the standard algorithm way. I was doing all kinds of other nifty ways of playing with the numbers. To me, that's how you do faster calculation speed. You find all kinds of shortcuts, which is itself fun. It's like, it's fun to say, oh, what's the fastest way to times 3 on this? Don't do the 7 times 3 and get 21 over 24. Instead, cancel out this way. 3, 24 gives you an 8, you're done. I would just say, if you always look at any arithmetic problem, even as a puzzle, you sort of keep trying to say, is there like a more clever way to do it? Actually, I'll share that with you. That is what I do. If I ever see myself doing any task, even if it's as boring as multiplying two numbers, I always try to say, what is the most clever way I could do this task? And then it becomes entertaining. And by the way, if you do this, you do get faster. Try that. Actually, another thing about increasing speed in general, it's just if you decide that you want to do something fast, you learn how to focus on it and not let your mind drift and do something else. Actually, that's one of the most powerful skills. if you can figure out how to say, I've got this task, I want to nail it, and I can push everything else out of the way, even if it's really distracting around me, just get it. That's a really useful skill. And then eventually, when you find yourself trying to do more things fast, whatever they may be, it's pretty good. Okay, more questions. Bing test. Are you wearing slippers right now? No, I am not. Although I will tell you, I'm wearing sneakers. One of the very fun parts of doing, I guess, remote everything is that you actually don't have to wear uncomfortable shoes everywhere you go. So yes, I am actually wearing sneakers, and I'm very happy for that. Although I'm probably going to regret it when I go home, because I have this thing where the uncomfortable shoes that I wear are at least waterproof. But the problem is, where I am right now in Pennsylvania, we just got a big mountain of snow. So I know what's going to happen when I go back to my car after this. I'm going to have these shoes, I'm going to be stepping through snow, it's going to get into my shoes, and then I'm going to go and push all the snow off of the car. And by the time I get into the car, my shoes are going to be all wet. So I should probably have actually worn the uncomfortable shoes today. As you can see, this is how I think about the world. There's like if you do this, then what happens, and so on. And I'm already thinking ahead of this. Oh no, that was a mistake. Is it snowing? Toady Master asks. I don't know the answer to that question, because I haven't been looking out the window all day, but it was snowing, and in Pennsylvania we got a big pile. Actually, normally I wouldn't even have bothered to come in today, but because of this live stream, I said, you know, I owe it to all you guys. I'm going to show up and make sure we do this live stream. But normally I would have been like, too much snow. Maybe not. But you guys are important. More questions. Oh, wow. Lots of fun questions. Okay. Some person asked me, did you study linear algebra in college? And the answer is yes. Actually, I recommend that everybody who wants to do something in like math, technology, computer science, artificial intelligence, machine learning, make sure you study a class called linear algebra. Linear algebra is a class that lets you figure out, you know, very systematic ways to solve these kinds of questions. All these letters. You know, we were saying, wow, five letters, so much. Well, actually, in the real world, you're doing this with like thousands, millions of letters. And it turns out that there are other ways that you can solve this other than the stare-at-it method. The stare-at-it method actually works very poorly in that context. So this this idea of using linear algebra is very useful for handling lots of these linear equations. But the other thing that linear algebra helps you to do also is it's actually at the heart of a lot of things inside statistics. When you have like lots of different things you're measuring at the same time and you're trying to figure out how they relate to each other, it turns out that, especially if those things are random, it turns out there are some notions of what's called covariance. And as you learn a statistics class, you'll come across all these things. And so linear algebra is one of the core skills. In fact, I'm often interviewing people these days, like as candidates for something called a Hertz Foundation Fellowship. And whenever there's somebody who says they want to do machine learning or artificial intelligence, I ask them a lot of questions about linear algebra. Because if you want to make innovations at the forefront of all of these fancy fields, it's actually really useful to know all of the theory behind these like systems of equations. Okay, more questions. Serena Shao asked, are you going to do more of these live streams? Well, thanks to MathCounts, the answer is yes. If not for MathCounts, the answer would actually be no. Because as some of you know, I'm working as hard as I can to try to get rid of this COVID virus, which these days is getting more and more scary. So I spend almost all my time doing that. But because I care about MathCounts, and because we decided to do this collaboration, I'm actually going to be doing a lot of these live streams, because we're going to be talking about the next round, the chapter competition, in some time. I already forgot when. It's on the website somewhere. On our website, we say, when's the next live stream, chapter problems. And then after that, we're going to do the live stream for the chapter invitational. And then we're going to do the live stream for the state. And then we're going to do the live stream for the national. That's going to be hard. You guys are all going to have to help me on that. But it's just like, we are going to have quite a lot of these, simply because MathCounts exists. So if you like this, you can thank them. Let's keep going. More questions. Alan Lee, how do you increase speed without sacrificing accuracy? If you can increase speed and still do every question in two different ways, you won't sacrifice accuracy. But if you increase speed and you just kind of go, you might fall off the tracks. You might sacrifice accuracy. When I say two different ways, there's two notions of two different ways. One is like here's a solution, here's another solution. Oh, you know what you would do with this one? If you actually got this, let's just give an example. If I figured out what A and O and U and E are, I can figure out what I is. I'll just figure that out. I plus A plus E is 6. Okay, so that means I, where is the A and the E? There we go. So I is 3. And then what I would do is I would plug them all back in to double check. That's a totally different way to go and see if everything's consistent. I would just go plug, 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 make them all check. If they all check, I'm happy. So what I'm saying is go and speed, but speed with two different ways, which are as different as possible. If you're two speedings all give you the same answer, then it's probably right. Okay. What else do we have? More questions. Oh my gosh. Bing Tests says, should I plan on taking AP Stats or AP Linear Algebra when I get to high school? I didn't even know there was an AP Linear Algebra in high school. All I knew was there was an AP Stats. My advice there is it's entirely based on how it's taught. If you happen to have a school which has a very good linear algebra at high school, go for it. That's good. But when I say very good, what I mean is if you're really ambitious and eventually want to do hard things, you will need to take a hard class on linear algebra from university. And for example, where I teach, Carnegie Mellon University, there are many people who take linear algebra in high school who then come to college and take it again, but they take like the advanced version with us. So I would say it depends on how challenging the course is that you've got at the high school. Oh, Jennifer Chan, what grade would be good to take the AMC 10? Now, this is a MathCounts stream, but I'll generally answer if it happens to be any math competition, I usually say as long as you kind of can do a few questions, one question, two questions, three questions, go for it. And that actually applies to MathCounts also. There are a lot of people who think, well, MathCounts is just middle school, so why am I even paying attention? I'm a fifth grader, or I'm a fourth grader, I won't pay attention. No, actually, you don't have to do it for winning a contest. Even if you're not eligible, you can still play with the problems. With the AMC 10, the limiting factor is actually not your eligibility. In fact, you know, like a preschooler is also eligible to take the AMC 10. I mean, if you happen to be 4 years old and you want to take the AMC 10, the only rule is less than or equal to 10th grade, 4 years old counts. The limiting factor is if you go to the high school, your local high school, as a four-year-old and sit down trying to take the AMC 10, all the teachers and the rest of the high school students would probably rather that you're not there because you might be disruptive, right? So it's mainly if you can find a place to do it, go for it. Strongly recommended. And even if you can't, play with the questions. More things. Oh, Yaffe asked, do these interfere with your actual job? I don't know what my job is, to be honest. I mean, I'm a math professor at Carnegie Mellon University, so in some sense, that's my job. But if you Google me or if you look at the work that I'm working on, what I really do is I just go and think every day of how I can go and use math and the math that I know to try to make the world a better place. That's actually what I do. And so this counts. And so, you know, right now anyway, most people are at home eating dinner where I live. So this is not really interfering with the actual job. It's more of just, let's go and use this time when all of you are available to go and talk about something. But actually, I also do like these YouTube videos as part of my actual job. If you want to know what my actual job is, you just have to tune into this channel on Monday, Wednesday, and Friday at 2:10 p.m. I now know the time because my first day of class was today. So I actually know when my class is now. It's 2:10 p.m. And that's actually my job. That's my Carnegie Mellon class. And if you want to see what the college students are listening to and learning about, it's free thanks to the internet. Okay, more things. I see a lot of people have asked about Novid. That is exactly what I'm working on. I just want to be very respectful to MathCounts that this is supposed to be more about the MathCounts, less about the Novid. If at some point later MathCounts and I decide to do some kind of collaboration about that, I'll tell you more. But for now, I'll just simply say Novid is something we came up with, which is a totally different way to try to fight diseases, which is about giving everyone a radar to see how far away diseases are. If you're curious about any more than that, just like Google it around and you'll find some stuff. And it's not that I don't care about it, it's just that this is MathCounts' stream, so I'll focus on that here. Ah, Banana Watch asked, what was your youth like? Did you play sports? So I didn't play organized sports, but I had two siblings. I was the oldest. So I played the sports called chasing everyone around and getting chased around in the backyard. Does that count? And we also did things like ride bicycles around the neighborhood. Actually, in retrospect, it turns out that was called let dad get exercise. That's actually what happened. My dad would go and exercise by running around the neighborhood, and we would like bicycle around behind him. We thought it was fun, but actually, I think he was just getting exercise. Anyway, so this is the kind of stuff that I was doing. I actually didn't do math competitions in the elementary school because we had no idea what they were. That's what I mean. Like when you grow up in the 1980s and the 1990s, nobody knew all of these things were around. Now you do. That's why you're all smarter than us. Okay, more questions. Some person, how do you do math with such an attitude? Well, I think it's actually because the problems are interesting. Have you ever watched me do a page of multiplication problems? No, I don't think I would find that very interesting either. The interesting thing here was like, they're interesting questions. I'm curious, and I don't know how to do them. If you can see what's, okay, maybe this is a thing about personality and psychology, right? What MathCounts taught me from being a student is that the interesting problems are the ones that you don't know how to do, which is kind of counterintuitive. Usually when you're younger, you think the ones you don't know how to do are scary, and I don't like them. But what MathCounts teaches you is like, come on, they're all hard, right? And then some of them are like, I've seen it before. Okay, not so challenging. And sometimes it's like, whoa, how are you supposed to do this? I don't know. It's a challenge. And then you get an attitude. The attitude is like, okay, I'm going to go and figure this out. This is going to be fun. So that's where that comes from. Okay. Oh, Jennifer Chang, how should you approach a class that teaches you math that you have already learned? Well, here's how I think. I've already learned one way of doing it. That's the way I know. Maybe I've learned two ways, maybe I've learned three, but I don't yet know what's the way that you're about to teach me how to do it. And I'm curious. It's like watching a movie again, but from a different angle. Has anyone ever watched a movie more than once? If you watch a movie more than once, what do you notice? You notice all kinds of like different things that you didn't notice the first time. So it's like, you don't have to be bored. You know, I actually would often watch, even like, if I watch a teacher, it might be like, You know, when I was a kid, I would also watch teachers teach, and I would be like, you know, that's an interesting way of explaining it. How might I try to explain it? Because by the way, understanding it yourself is a totally different task, than explaining it to people who don't get it. If you think about it, you know what, I'm going to tell you. It is. You know why I do these live streams? It's so easy to teach you guys how to do these problems. What's hard is to teach people who don't know some of the more basic pieces, how the basic pieces work. That's actually really hard. That takes skill. That takes emotional intelligence. That takes all kinds of things. It is super easy to teach people who already are pretty advanced how to tinker around with this stuff, right? And so, you know, when I was a student, I'd also be watching. It's like, it's not really bored. You know, like all the people around you don't know those concepts yet. Maybe not all of them, but a lot of them. That's why the teacher's teaching it. And it's actually kind of interesting to go and see, how would you try to teach somebody who doesn't know? And here's what I would do then, because I'd kind of watch. And then in the classes where I was in, there would always be like some time to go and work on your problems afterwards, like the homework or whatever. And I'd go and help the people who were around me. I'd be like, trying to learn what I've learned from watching the teacher and try to see if I can help people who might not get it to get it, because that was fun. I don't know. So then I wasn't bored. I actually really liked all those classes, even if I already knew the stuff. It was like watching a movie again, or like, you know, it was fun. And you got to make friends. And big tip, don't be like one of these people who's like the irritating guy in class to the teacher. That just doesn't get you anywhere. Okay, let's do one more question just because, you know, we're close to the end on the time. And I do see that there's a question here about skipping a problem, right? So let's just finish off this one. When would you skip a problem? Okay, how much time should you spend on these last few problems? When should you skip a problem? Now, the way I usually am is I actually do try to dig in and solve a problem. I keep track of how I'm doing on time. Since every question is worth the same number of points, you know, It is worthwhile to skip over one sometimes, but I don't get a habit of skipping too much because it takes time to read a problem, understand it, and that might have been half the time it takes to solve the problem. So I will actually go and understand it, not panic, try a few things, and only if those don't work or if they look like they'll take me forever to finish, then I'd skip. But I would generally try not to skip if I could avoid skipping. How you get better at that is you try a lot of practices, like, you know, this practice competition. And that gets you better at understanding, you know, what you can do without skipping. I hope that this was somehow fun. I'm glad we had the chance to answer the random questions at the end. I'll see you again soon, whether in the Carnegie Mellon class or in this MathCounts competition collaboration. Happy Monday. Be safe, everyone. And good night. Oops.